New York State Senate. We have a quorum. In attendance is Senator Andrea Stewart Cousins, Senator Bonasik, Senator Johnson, Senator Honorato, and a ranking member of the committee, Senator Farley. Today we have a great good fortune and honor of having the Superintendent of the Banking Department, Richard Neiman, give us a presentation on banking within the state of New York. He was going to give this presentation at our last meeting. However, at that time he was called to Washington on rather short notice, and certainly in keeping with having good federal and state governmental relations, we wanted to postpone his presentation here until he had the time. So today he's with us. I'd like to thank you, Richard, for joining our committee. And once we hear from the superintendent, if there are any questions for him, we'll certainly entertain those. And following this presentation and questions, we'll then entertain the nominations to the Municipal Bond Bank Agency. With that said, welcome you, Richard.
Thank you.
For our committee, and please go ahead.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Foley, Ranking Member Farley, and distinguished members of the committee. I very much appreciate being here today on behalf of the Banking Department to discuss our priorities for 2010. I look forward to your questions on the full scope of the Department's responsibilities, but I intend to focus my opening remarks, as you requested, on our progress in implementing state laws and programs, particularly those designed to protect consumers and to promote economic inclusion. So what I'd like to do is highlight three areas before touching on some other areas impacting the department. And those three areas involve the Banking Development District Program, the registration of mortgage loan originators and mortgage loan servicers, and the recently passed governor's program bill that expands the scope of protections to homeowners in preventing foreclosures. Each of these programs contributes to the state's multi-pronged efforts to address the current financial crisis and to help ensure that a housing problem of this magnitude never happens again. The current foreclosure crisis is partially a result of insufficient access to traditional credit. When banks are absent from a community, non-traditional service providers, or even predatory lenders, we unfortunately know, may fill the vacuum. It's estimated that 761,000, or almost 10% of households in New York State, do not have a banking account of any kind. Another 1.5 million, or almost 20% of New Yorkers, may have an account but still rely on more expensive non-bank service providers such as check cashers. Lack of access is only part of the problem, however. We also need innovative products and services tailored to the needs of currently unbanked or underbanked consumers. The Banking Development District Program is designed to fill these gaps by combining access to the right products and services with financial literacy and by developing long-term customer relationships and greater opportunities for economic inclusion. Last year, we held community hearings across the state on the BDD program to solicit feedback and ideas for improvement from a wide range of stakeholders. We are now in the process of finalizing a report on the hearings that will present our findings and future actions for program enhancement. I am very pleased to preview the findings. In fact, this is the first preview of our findings with you this morning. The department has identified a number of next steps within our existing authority to improve the program, and let me just cite three examples. Including the provision of financial education as a requirement for participation. Sufficient lead time will be given to current branches to identify appropriate partners and curricula to satisfy this requirement. We strongly recommend that branches consider fulfilling this requirement by partnering with a third-party non-for-profit for whom such services are part of the organization's primary mission. Two, encouraging BDD branches to provide additional affordable banking products and services. Many branches have innovative offerings such as small dollar loans, remittance products, technical assistance, and free tax preparation services. However, we believe that more needs to be done. Consequently, applications for the BDD program will be required to include more detailed information on the costs associated with their so-called affordable products, beyond just the basic banking account mandated under state law. And three, developing assessment criteria for determining when to allow multiple branches within a single designated district. Recent state legislation clarified that the department may now designate multiple BDD branches within a single district. We are considering the standards we would use to permit entry by a second branch into a district, or even the creation of a new district with partial territorial overlap. This would include an assessment of the competitive impact on the existing BDD branch, which may be a particular concern in more sparsely populated geographies, particularly upstate. We are committed to improving the administration of the BDD program and are considering convening forums that would promote an ongoing exchange of ideas between stakeholders once our report is issued. In addition, our report will highlight areas which would require legislative action or approval of the State Comptroller's Office. An especially urgent issue is the need to reduce the cost of collateral. There is a major concern that the cost of collateralizing the subsidized deposits by the financial institutions exceeds the benefits and is discouraging program participation. Currently, the State Comptroller only accepts U.S. Treasury bonds or notes or Federal Home Loan Bank letters of credit as collateral. There is another option, however, and that's the Certificate of Deposit Account Registry Service Program, known as CDARS, which I believe would greatly reduce the collateral cost without sacrificing security for municipal deposits. Using an electronic settlement process, the CDARS network allows participating banks to invest customer funds at other member institutions through reciprocal matched FDIC-insured deposit transactions. The CDARS program is distinctive in that funds in excess of FDIC insurance limits at a single institution will still be eligible for full coverage and yet effectively remain a deposit in the local bank through which the funds were invested. To date, 39 states have availed themselves of this innovative network that provides the ability to deal with one bank and receive up to $50 million in insured deposits. The department is of the opinion that CDARS is already compliant with New York law. However, the State Comptroller is of the belief that legislation is needed. We are committed to working with you and the Comptroller to expedite the legislative process. Now let me move to our efforts to implement the registration of mortgage loan originators and mortgage loan servicers. Another key consumer protection initiative is the Department's registration of mortgage loan originators, MLOs. This involves registration of individual employees of these mortgage brokerage firms and not just the firms where they are employed. The process involves rigorous background checks, fingerprinting, education requirements, and testing. Entry in this national database will help to curb mortgage fraud, as it will be more difficult for fraudsters to evade enforcement and reopen shops by crossing state lines. The registration is also part of New York's participation in the National Mortgage Licensing System, a state-run effort through the Conference of State Bank Supervisors to create more uniform industry standards. The NMLS has also been an opportunity for an enhanced level of state-federal cooperation, which I often cite as an example of a new federalism. The Federal SAFE Act for registering of MLOs relies on the NMLS as the primary system. A federal backup structure will be created to cover originators in states that do not elect to join the nationwide system. The MLO registration process involves a major commitment of the department's resources. To date, over 15,000 individual MLOs have applied through the system, and an additional 500 or more are anticipated. This heightened screening process has already yielded results in enhanced consumer protection. To date, 27 of the individuals who might otherwise be selling mortgage loans in New York have been denied MLO status. The bulk of these MLO applications are still in the process of completing their educational requirements and testing requirement. Applicants are expected to send all the missing documentation to the department by May 30th to be assured of receiving a decision by the July 31 deadline. MLO applicants that fail to submit timely information may face an interruption in their ability to conduct business after that deadline. A major focus of the department's effort, therefore, has been to promptly notify applicants of their status. Let me turn to mortgage servicers. A related effort involves the registration of mortgage servicers who perform the payment processing and collection work after a loan has been originated. This group was previously unregulated in the state, but became subject to the department's jurisdiction as a part of the comprehensive state mortgage reforms enacted last year. Currently, we have received applications for registration from 44 servicers and notification of exempt status from approximately 125 additional entities. Registration and supervisory oversight of MLOs and servicers is a massive new undertaking, but one that is vital to ensuring the integrity of the mortgage market in New York. As part of this registration process, the department has prepared draft regulations to cover the conduct of business of servicers, as well as model forms such as disclosures for yield spread premiums. These regulations address such areas as servicer obligations to borrowers, handling of consumer complaints, mortgage delinquencies, and the crediting of payments and regulatory reporting, including with respect to loss mitigation. A copy of the draft regulations is available on our website, and we are working with stakeholders to refine these regulations. We also continue working with the mortgage servicers, the Treasury Department, consumer groups, and borrowers to keep families in their homes. I should emphasize in this effort, we are working in one of the two state banking departments, working with a multi-state group of banking departments and state attorneys general in meeting on a regular basis with servicers and issuing regular reports. So now let me turn to implementation of the governor's program bill, which I am sure you all are very proud of. As you know, the legislation was signed on December 15th and builds on the protections in the landmark subprime lending reforms enacted last year. The housing crisis, which began in subprime, is expanding, and families with all types of loans are now facing foreclosure. The governor's bill addresses this evolving crisis by providing new protections for both prime borrowers and renters, which also expands the responsibility of the banking department. With respect to prime borrowers, the 90-day notice and mandatory settlement conferences now apply to all home loans, not just subprime. Effective February 13th of this year, lenders that serve a 90-day notice, and that's, remember, 90 days in advance of filing a foreclosure process, all borrowers are now required to receive this notice outlining the names of housing counselors in their area, as well as the details of their delinquency and the fact that a foreclosure notice may be filed. So beginning February 13th of this year, lenders that serve a 90-day notice are also required to file the information in that notice with the banking department within 3 days to allow the banking department and the Division of Housing Community Renewal to offer targeted assistance to distressed homeowners. In less than a month of operations, we've already received over 5,500 filings from 60 different servicers. An even higher filing rate is anticipated going forward, as there have been over 50,000 properties each year in some stage of the foreclosure process since the financial crisis began. We are finalizing a confidentiality agreement to facilitate the sharing of this borrower information with housing counselors, who will reach out directly to borrowers in default in an effort to avoid foreclosures. The following statistics are based on approximately 2,500 of the 5,000 filings, as the remainder was just received in a bulk shipment that is being processed. Even this initial information, however, reveals important trends. The top 10 counties with the highest number of filings account for just over 60% of all filing activity in the state. These top 10 counties are Suffolk, Nassau, Queens, Monroe, Kings, Erie, Orange, Westchester, the Bronx, and Dutchess. These counties have been consistently identified as hard hit from the beginning of the foreclosure crisis. And within the coming weeks, more complete data and analysis will be available. This database will be a premier source of mortgage and economic data for the state. Even the limited information available from a few weeks' worth of activity is already yielding insights into lending and housing patterns in New York. Having this information will enable the state to better allocate outreach efforts and funds to support communities at high risk of foreclosure. It will also enable the department to evaluate the loss rates and loss mitigation efforts of supervised financial institutions and prevent predatory practices. And since I already see a number of bank representatives here from both national banks and state banks, you know, I do want to highlight the level of cooperation that we have received from not only the state banks, but also the large national banks who are participating in the program and working effectively with us, not only in the development of the rules, but also in the implementation. I think I can't overemphasize the use of the impact that this legislation is going to have at the state level, because not only will the information that's provided to us by the banks enable us to outreach to borrowers, to provide them additional information to reach out to their to banks to take advantage of that 90-day period through additional counseling opportunities, but it will also provide us a wealth of information needed to be able to analyze where foreclosures are likely to be pursued throughout the state, as well as the types of mitigation efforts. I think one fact that is often lost here is, and we will also assess what percentage of those filings actually do lead to a foreclosure, and that could be a small percentage, but I think it's important to understand how that process works through to the extent that they are resolved through alternative means other than an outright foreclosure. So, and then before I move on to that, that's why I commend this committee and the legislature, as well as the governor, for adopting that important piece of legislation, which I believe is a model and a landmark piece of legislation among the nation. And that has often been reinforced to me, particularly by community groups who have said this serves as a role model for the rest of the nation. So now let me move to some of our budget, staffing, and operational issues facing the department. The banking department's ability to fill our mandates and remain at the forefront of financial services regulation is largely dependent on the expertise of our staff. We continue to face the loss of experienced examiners through retirement, and the result is a knowledge gap in new examiners. In addition, budget restraints over the last year limited our ability to hire additional staff to replace the loss of examiners and address the labor-intensive needs of our new responsibilities in regulating the mortgage banking industry. The good news is that the governor's recommended budget for 2010-11 restores 15 of the 30 positions lost in July of 2009. This is a first step in restoring the adequate staffing and training needed to continue to be an effective competitive regulator. With the approval of this budget, we will prioritize our needs and hire key positions, including examination staff at the entry level. Now, I can't leave this morning without touching on regulatory reform at the federal level. The department faces other challenges well beyond our resource issue. The ability to fulfill our mandate also hinges on the outcome of regulatory reform at the federal level. Proposals are pending in Congress which could undermine the viability of the dual banking system. Consolidation of regulatory agencies at the federal level with new fee structures could create incentives for banks to abandon the state charter. These incentives would be targeted to particularly appeal to large banks, which would leave states with oversight of smaller and regional institutions. With 33% of the banking department's depository assessments derived from our 7 largest institutions, the loss of our largest charters would result in greatly increased assessments for the remaining banks, and drive additional conversions to the federal charter. Other provisions related to the scope of federal preemption will impact New York's ability to adopt and enforce laws against national banks and protect consumers. The Supreme Court's decision last year in Cuomo versus Clearinghouse upheld the state's traditional authority in consumer protection. Legislation is needed, however, to ensure that national standards remain a floor which states can choose to exceed. So let me wrap up. We will continue our efforts to influence the outcome of regulatory reform discussions and debates through direct outreach and meetings, with the administration, with the Treasury, and Congress, particularly the New York delegation. New York has led the way in passing the most comprehensive mortgage reforms in the country, and states must retain the ability to adopt effective laws that can serve as national models. I look forward to continuing to work with the committee in protecting consumers and promoting economic inclusion. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I look forward to our dialogue and questions.
And thank you, Ms. Neiman, for your very comprehensive presentation on a number of banking issues that are confronting the state. Before I ask some questions and make some comments to the members of the committee, Senator Farley, any points you'd like to raise?
Just a few. I spoke with the Lieutenant Governor, who seemed to be gravely concerned about the sweeping of funds that is in this budget out of your department, and the effect that it may have on bank examiners and trying to attract bank examiners. And it's been my understanding that your staff is, I'll just say, rather mature as opposed to being old. But for you to be able to attract bank examiners at a rather modest salary and so forth is a problem. And he spoke to that, and that concern that he has and that I have about the sweeping of funds in the budget, which we have opposed historically. And as another part of the question, which kind of concerned me, he spoke of a fact that some of the smaller banks, which you quote, the smaller banks, might be in insolvency, jeopardy, or anything like that. Is there any? That kind of surprised me, because my general feeling was that, particularly in the upstate area and so forth, the smaller banks were very solvent, very healthy.
Okay, so let's start with the last one, because that really is the overriding objective of our department, and my responsibility with respect to the safety and soundness of banks chartered in New York. Clearly, we are have as our key priority safety and soundness, and as any bank commissioner in the country are dealing with banking issues, particularly arising out of commercial real estate. We do have a small group of banks that are requiring careful and regular on-site supervision, and I don't think we are immune from those issues. I think overall, our community banks and state charter banks are rather healthy in the state, particularly when compared to other regions in the country that had the large increase in real estate and commercial real estate prices, and they are now suffering from the a more dramatic decline. Having said that, in talking about the overall health and how our community banks in particular have fared reasonably well through this crisis, that doesn't mean that we don't have a handful of banks that are requiring close monitoring.
Are they geographic and specific, or?
I just want to be careful. You've always been so cautious when discussing things at the national level, and the FDIC puts out the number they have of, you know, 500 to 800 banks on a problem list, I think, in a bank, a state our size, where the problem banks can be counted on a hand or two, I think is, I'm cautious of a practice where individual banks can be singled out at the time.
I don't want to do that, I know. But I on balance, I think that we can be proud of the New York State banking system because it's been very solid and very strong vis-a-vis national.
That's
let's,
right.
Let's go to your the sweeping so the, funds. How you
so, you know, we, that is a practice that has been initiated as of over the of the last year or so that has resulted in concern by the department, particularly with respect to planning for those sweeps. I mean, these are funds that have been assessed. We can only still spend funds up to what we had assessed and collected. So that continues to be a concern of the department, particularly in planning for those sweeps. So that in sharing an overall assessment, you know, with Lieutenant Governor, these are the types of issues that we did have raised with him. I also want to introduce the senior members of my staff, Tom Barlett, our legislative counsel, and Diana Roulon, who's been a long-time important senior official in our office with respect to operations, and is my chief operating officer.
Very good. Thank you, Superintendent. And
I think you also asked a question about competitive salaries. And that does continue to remain a concern, particularly, we've always known that it's been difficult and impossible to remain competitive with the private industry, but now we're finding greater challenges remaining competitive with federal agencies. The FDIC, in particular, has been on a hiring spree, and we have lost individuals to the FDIC and just have not been able to remain
I think I've seen that as a problem, Brian.
We've seen that, absolutely right.
And these are the people that examine our banks, you know, and you've got to have qualified, decent people there.
We have over 22% of our total examination force are now eligible for retirement.
We're finding that, Superintendent, in a number of departments throughout the state, there's that challenge of the number of who are not just eligible to retire, but who will most likely retire, and really lack, in some cases, of a mentoring program within different departments. This is not just here, I've seen it at the local level as well. But what would be helpful is if you could give us, both chair and ranker, the salaries at the federal level that seem to be persuading some of our, that are causing some loss of some of our most experienced professional staff.
So it's like to see a comparison.
Comparison. That would be helpful. Number two, I want to thank you for the great speed with which you've moved forward in administering the new mortgage reforms that came into effect in December. Those reforms, you mentioned the government, also this legislature, in a bipartisan fashion, strongly supported. And having some of the hardest hit communities in the state in the foreclosure area, these reforms are going to be crucial to helping those families. What I would take note of, and first I'd ask that you have a copy of the remarks that would be distributed to all membership.
We've brought
extra
copies.
But certainly, focusing on the communities that have a high risk and an actuality of foreclosures, that's going to be very important for your banking department, and the attempt to mitigate these foreclosures and having more of an involvement of your department in those fields, as outlined in the law, will be very, very helpful. It will be very crucial in trying to mitigate as many foreclosures as possible. And I see the department playing a great role in that, and I think the laws that we approved last year will arm the department to be of more help, both in analysis, research, but also direct intervention. And that's going to be very helpful.
I can highlight one program that I have
been quite outspoken on in trying to encourage the administration and the Treasury to utilize TARP funds to fund state efforts to support emergency mortgage assistance programs for individuals who have fallen behind on payments because of a loss of income, reduced income, or loss of job. And that is a segment, a growing segment of people at risk of foreclosure. And I think we're making a bit of headway with the Treasury. In fact, the President announced just 2 weeks ago a pilot project of providing $1.5 billion to five high-impact states, where they will provide those funds to the state housing finance agencies for development of innovative programs, including programs like I just mentioned, emergency mortgage assistance.
How does it impact from New York State as far as qualifying those programs?
Well, they've limited it to five states.
We're not the top five.
That's the good news. The good news is that we haven't reached that in order to qualify.
But is there a way of...
Well, that is what our continuing press...
Notwithstanding the fact that we're not in the top five, thankfully, but within the state, there are areas that are much harder hit than other areas. And I would dare say if we looked at those particular communities, vis-a-vis communities within the five states, I think you'd see some similarities. So there needs to be like a more discreet, nuanced look at the potential of using these TARP funds, not just at a state level, but I would say within communities, within states, those communities are much harder hit than would the statewide average belie. Okay? So I think that's important that you can take a look at that. Secondly, you mentioned, that as you did last year, the potential of these proposed federal laws to do great harm to our dual banking charter here in the state. Of course, this committee stands ready, willing, and able to assist you in trying to prevent that from being naturalized. I'm asking what kind of help can we give you in order to ensure that these proposed laws, in fact, don't hurt our dual charter system? What do we need to do to help you and help the state?
Well, you know, continuing to reach out to members of our delegation, particularly, you know, Senator Schumer, who sits on the Banking Committee, those members. I issued a letter yesterday that I will provide to the committee that I sent to Senator Shelby and Chairman Dodd, with copies to both our senators, highlighting my concern of a risk of us losing the Federal Reserve as our partner in supervising U.S. branches of foreign banks. Mm-hmm. This week, the press is reporting that Senator Dodd is considering shifting the Federal Reserve's authority for institutions below $100 billion, state-chartered institutions below $100 billion, to the FDIC. I think our loss of institution, of partnership with the Fed could jeopardize our oversight responsibility for not only the largest state member.
That would be terrible.
But particularly the U.S. licensed agencies. We have responsibility for over 80% of all the assets held by foreign banks in the U.S. are state licensed. And I think this is an issue that's been under the radar. So I will provide a copy to you as provided, and we also intend to circulate it to
members of the committee. That doesn't help. We certainly want to keep those powers in the state. That said, we want to thank you, Superintendent, and distribute copies, and we will follow up quickly. Certainly on the budget matters, as you know, last year we were successful through this committee to allocate additional 25 positions for the bank.
Right.
But as we all well know, what the legislature proposes does not necessarily mean that executive disposes, and there may have been a number of vacancies, budgeted vacancies within those 25 positions. But certainly I think it gives you an appreciation that this committee wants to be helpful to your department so you can responsibly carry out the duties of the department. So going through this budget cycle, no doubt, we'll be mindful of those things. Try to keep the positions in the department. We know sweeps, as you said, in a rather elegant way. Those sweeps are something that have been reviewed and let's say been undertaken in different departments, and we're sensitive to that, to see how we can mitigate that, minimize that within your different department. We know how important this department is to your overall efforts. That is sound, safe banking system, and also to elevate, also this way, to highlight consumer protections of the department in these times when many families are suffering because of at least the threat of foreclosure. And I like what you said earlier, which was part of the analysis and research that you undertake, is not just the, let's say, the initial stage of foreclosure, which it's important for us to know those things, but the outcome,
right?
How many actually were foreclosed. Hopefully it'll be a far smaller number than was initiated. And I think the laws that we passed last year should help to minimize that, and your department's, let's say, management and administration of that particular law and reforms, as I said, are of nationwide significance. We hope that this will help families stay in the home.
I mean, you know, it really is remarkable, because when you think about where we have come in the department and the priority that has been given to this foreclosure effort, and that's not something that, to my knowledge, the department has ever dedicated a great deal of resources. Obviously, this is was an evolving crisis, but the fact that the department keeping, you know, directed their efforts toward that, despite the fact that they've got existing responsibilities on day jobs of supervising chartered entities and still operating under a staffing and budget restraints, were able to continue to dedicate additional time and resources and effort.
I think we were one of the first states to really address this problem, move on it. And we were a beacon, I think, out there.
So I think that's why it's given me credibility, you know, at the national level, to raise the types of, both to be able to have a voice at the federal level because of what we've done at the state level. All right, we've got copy.
George, do you have a question? Senator Honorado has a question, please, Superintendent.
I'm just wondering, you know, since we deregulated, the Feds deregulated the bank, New York State did not go along with the deregulation. We still have regulation on state chartered banks. How are they comparing with the losses of bankruptcies compared to the federal unregulated banks? How many went under?
Well, I mean, I guess I wouldn't refer to national banks as unregulated. You know, I believe we have a comparable system of regulation. Certainly, in the areas of consumer protection, we have some concern of the controller's overreach, as well as the OTS overreach of the federal preemption with respect to consumer laws. The CSBS on a regular basis does a comparison of bank failures between national charters and state charters, you know, recognizing that there are certainly a greater number of state charters by number than there are national banks. And I'd be happy to share that information with you if you are interested in getting a sense of the failures of over the last, you know, 18 months. How do they compare by charter type, if that was your question?
Okay. Well, thank you again, Superintendent. I appreciate your responsiveness.
Great.
Okay. So two matters before
us. Oh, yeah.
Us.
So we have a little housekeeping.
We have a little housekeeping, two nominations.
Thank you.
If you'd like to stay after the Superintendent, that is fine.
Yeah.
And we have two bills in front of us. One is the nomination of Naomi Bayer as the director of the Municipal Bond Agency. Municipal Bond Bank Agency, is there a motion to that effect? Motion by Senator Farley, second by Senator Honorado, all in favor? Opposed? Motion is approved. Ms. Bayer will now move on to the finance. I believe it's going to be a dual reference to finance. Next is William Myers, Director of Municipal Bond Bank Agency.
Move the nomination.
Nomination by Senator Farley, second by Senator Honorado. Any questions on the motion?
Aye.
Hearing none, all in favor, opposed. Motion approved. Not any other business to be brought before the committee. Chair, entertain a motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.
Motion seconded, all in favor, opposed. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.